And there are two sessions planned, 1 hour and then another 1 hour. So because of you can hear me on the back? Okay. So because of that, we have to adjust the time. So we have combined, and something you will see both the sessions combined here. And I'll finish up at 11, and then 11 to 11:30 is your closing, right? So we'll be done on time. She was worried, and it's her worry was very genuine because you have to close at 11:30 and go out. So we're done. Okay. So I'll take 45 minutes and then half an hour for our closing.
It's 15 minutes
closing because we already closed. Okay. So then I'll continue. We'll have some question answers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so there was a beggar, a poor guy, homeless guy. He used to like beg for things all his life. And there was a small place he used to sit there and ask for his alms and be begging. And he died after some time. And people knew he's a beggar, he's there sitting at one place for a long time, now he died. So they were taking him for cremation. So somebody said that, since the poor guy was sitting on this place for a long time, let's take some soil from this place and while doing cremation, we'll put the soil also with him because he was sitting. So they said, okay. So they started digging the soil. So when they were digging the soil, they found something inside. They dig deeper and they found a treasure there. The treasure was like all the ornaments and a lot of money. And they said, this guy was sitting on this place, begging all his life. When he died, they found a treasure below him. So actually he was sitting on the treasure, not knowing that I am sitting on the treasure. I am a beggar. And many of us like that. And especially when we are talking about the camps, Hindu heritage camp, we belong to a race, a glory, which is like a treasure nowhere in the world available. But sometimes we don't know which we are sitting on that treasure. And the purpose of all these camps, Baal Vihar, the programs, collective programs, is that to realize us that we have a treasure. We should not die as a beggar. We should die as a rich person. Right? So the goal is to reveal the treasure to us. So we go through different programs to just tell that this is the treasure we have. So can you, next slide. Shivani, what's your name? Shivani?
No.
Nina. Nina? Yeah, next slide. Can you be okay, guys?
Yeah.
Okay. So who we are? And that's the question. And this is all in American context, not India in the picture right now. Who we are? This is our identity. All of us. Of course, we are Indian in the sense, not Indian. Indian origin. People of Indian origin. That's what we are. Then American. We are all American citizens. I mean, most of us are American citizens. Our kids are born here. And then we are Hindu. So this is the identity. And so there is one balanced identity required in all of us. We want to maintain relationship with India because India is our ancestral land. We learn from India. We are American. We are all American. We owe to this country. This is our motherland actually. And then Hindu is identity. The practice. Our identity is Hindu. Who we are, Hindu. So this is a combined identity balance. And that's the challenge most of us face. As a parent, as an adult, we face how to balance this. We get into the dilemma that, I'm more Hindu, sometimes I'm more American, sometimes I'm more Indian. No, we have to have the balance. And all the programs should be, all our things should be balanced based on this. Okay, so this is a very famous quote. Albert Einstein said that we owe a lot to Indians. It's a very famous quote, and Albert Einstein actually said that. We go at the end, we'll see what he meant by that. But what we owe to Indians when he says that? I mean, Albert Einstein was a scientist. He didn't any help or science help from India. But this go back. There's more to it. So we have to look in between the lines what he meant by we owe to Indians. Now next slide. Because that is a sequence, right? Okay. So this is our multifaceted identity in America, right? Here's the kid. We do Upnayan Sanskar. Like in temples, we do Sanskaran. So here is a kid which Upnayan is done. This is my son. There is another kid who got America citizen by naturalization. So you get the certificate when you take oath. Like some of us who are not born in India, born here, we become American citizen, we take oath. There is a certificate there. So we are American by naturalization. Then there is a group of girls doing a Fogana dance in university. We see that university campuses, Fogana and Bhangra, all these girls, and they are all born and raised American girls. Why they are so interested in Fogana? Again, I go back to the same thing we talked yesterday. Heritage. That heritage is a combined word for all small, small things, guys. Yes, we have Bhavihar kids, like chanting some bhajan, like we did yesterday here. And wonderful shlokas they were chanting yesterday. Then here is a mandir, we are doing like our Shobha Yatra. We take around the Ganesh Ji in the mandir, and we all do it here. So this is our combined identity. We are American, we do sanskar, we do cultural program, we take part in the program. Now we are taking part in the politics also a little bit. So that is our identity. Again, so this is a picture. If you look at the left side, this is the crematorium. Typically in India, if you go to the crematorium, there is a ladies don't go to crematorium in India. Here, it's like crematorium. I mean, some of you may attended it. If you go to cremation, it's a very different ceremony that we used to do in India. So it's like crematorium. Like look at this wedding. Indian groom sitting on the horse is a very famous scene here. People come and you see that people walk from outside, oh, yes, there's an Indian wedding happening. They enjoy that drum one, so the groom sitting on the horse. Then the interfaith forums, I participate in the interfaith. I go to schools, public schools, and give talks. And this is a picture that there was a high school in Pittsburgh where the interfaith forum, and I go and give talks. And people take it very seriously. You won't believe, I have been going to Boy Scouts and different programs for 15 years. And they take it very seriously. I'm telling you, those kids are more serious than our kids in the camp sometimes. They ask questions, and it's a 1 hour session. They want to know more about Hindu values, not Hindu rituals per se, the Hindu values, Hindu traditions, what can make a difference in their life too. Hindu is not just for Hindus, the Hindu value. So that's our one of our faces. And of course, like we have relations with India, and Narendra Modi become Prime Minister, we welcome him in America. We run on the biggest program, like 60,000 people in Madison Square, welcoming Prime Minister of India. Because we have relationship with India. So all this is our combined identity. Okay, now, we are immigrants. Kids of immigrants, or we are immigrants. So here's a picture. Like the human was like this, and then finally the human has become very smart with all this tie and everything. Now in this picture, if you cannot read that, he said, let's turn around and go back, it's not worth the trip. So is it true? No. It's a one-way trip. This comic gives a different image. See, coming to America, for all of us, is a one-way trip. There's no going back to India. We are going to live here. We are going to create our own India, our own cultural Bharat right in this country. And make sure that this country also gained by that. Yoga day. We all know. All Americans are enjoying yoga. That's a Hindu value. We should propagate good Hindu values which everybody can practice. So there's no going back, right? Now we are here and we are not going to go back. We are establishing here the right things which Hindus can carry. And there is a quote in English that if we don't leave good for our kids, there is a quote says that the heaviest load to carry, listen carefully, look at the future 200 years down the line, the heaviest load to carry is when there is nothing to carry. If our kids 200 down the line, they say, oh, we have nothing to carry, that is the heaviest load we are going to transfer to them. Don't think that books is a load. Don't think that we can tell them memorize Gita. That's not the load. The practicing values. So it's very important for us to look at 200 years down the line. Next slide. Okay, now let's touch back a little bit of Hindu history, just to see who belong. The word Hindu, many of you know, but especially kids, it's very important to know that it's originated from Sapta Sindhu. But Hindu is a descriptor. Hindu is not a religion. The religion or the spiritual practice is Sanatan Dharma or Vedic Dharma. Hindu is a descriptor. But we don't want to get into that argument. The title is given to Hindus, so that's fine. They are Sanatan Dharma, but the title is because the world is saying they are Hindus. Not we say that. None of our scripture, entire Bhagavad Gita, entire Ved, the Hindu word is never used. Never used. Because we are Sanatan Dharma, Vedic Dharma. But outside world called us as Hindus. That's fine. Now Hindus have identity. So let's maintain their identity. And we know that by identity means we are practicing people who practice Vedic values. So this is, yeah, selected. And this is the chart, I mean, so the Hindu world civilization started, this is Iran, current day Iran, and this is, goes all the way to Pakistan. And this is entire India, this side. So the people who lived around this Sindhu river, which is become Indus now, are Hindus. And that's the Israeli civilization. This is the whole thing. But this is the history you can read. I'm sure you're reading in school, so I don't want to get into detail. But so all the tradition are related in Bharat, the Vedic tradition, Buddh, Jain, Sikh, they all are Hindu by the definition, by the descriptor. Practices will be different. I mean, I'm doing Durga Puja, somebody is doing Gauri Puja, somebody is doing Shiv Puja, Ganesh Puja, or Buddha Puja, or Mahavir Puja, or Guru Nanak, Guru Granth. Those are practices. But the descriptor, the identity is Hindu. So that's we need to understand when we talk to outsiders. And this is all I'm talking when we interact with the outside world also. So what the itihas has come from two words, iti and has. That means that is how it was. So our Ramayana, so typically this theme is Ramayana. So Ramayana is not a, typically people say that is a mythology. No, nothing is myth in Hinduism. Nothing is myth. Everything is right, true. Veda are true, Quran true, Ramayana is a history. So there is no myth. The word myth, mythology doesn't even exist in Hindu. We never talk, use that word. We use the word Veda, the book of knowledge, Quran, the stories, and the itihas, which is Ramayana and Mahabharata. So everything is true. There is no myth. So itihas is, actually it was like this. So Ram actually was there. Dashrath was there. Ram had son. So it was all the family lineage. Similarly, Mahabharata. So that will be very important. The misconception in the schools, they teach that, oh, India has this mythology. It's not mythology, it is true. And there are four pillars of the itihas, any history, like or the glory. So art and architecture, this is all India's art. If you go to India, many of you have visited, right? These are the temples, this is from that 500-year-old public school. I mean, they found in Israeli civilization, other, there was a school actually, 5,000 years old. And there is a school, the classrooms, everything is there. There were kitchen and all those things. So it was a pretty civilized society. And that those are the pillars of the history. Next slide. And then customs and traditions. That is, see now the history going back to architecture which left in India. But what we brought here is customs. And customs and traditions. Like I said, Upnayan Sanskar, Namaste. You know, at the airport when I am traveling, sometimes I travel like this on the weekends, some program. And sometimes even the TSA people or some people, they just say Namaste. They know that by looking at me, this looks like a Hindu or Indian guy, let's say Namaste. If you go to Chuck E. Cheese, it's very common. We used to take our kids when they were little to Chuck E. Cheese, they'll say Namaste. Because they know that this is a greeting by Hindus. Okay, so what is the meaning of Namaste now?
Yes.
What is the meaning of
speak
loud. You know what is Namaste means? What is Namaste?
You have to speak loud.
Okay, Reva.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll go. So what she said is, it's a every tradition has a way to greet, which is Namaste in the Hindu tradition and Indian tradition. She says, I'll bow down to you. That's correct. But we need to know the fundamental meaning. Then it will see, and I tell you, my office, and I work with non-Desis. My office is typically an American company, which I have a lot of white friends and all those things. And you won't believe, my office, when I say, Namaste, Sanjay Namaste, it's like that. Everybody likes that. Because I explain them the meaning, and the meaning is here, you're right, but this fundamental, Namahate, are two words. Namahate, Namah means I bow down, not to you as a body. Not to you, Atman within you, not soul. Hindu, the life word is Atman. The Atman, which is the life inside, energy, which is common. We'll come to Ekam Satma, right? Yesterday I threw the question. So, which is common in all of us, that Bhagwan, that Brahman is common. So I download the Brahman, the Atma, which is part of the Brahman in you. That's why I say Namaste. I bow down to you. Not to you this as a body. You as a people here in America, you spirit, right? Or soul. You say Atman. And that Atman is not a Hindu or Muslim or Christian. Atman is Atman, right? Atman has no religion. Because Atman is same thing even as animals. That is why Hindu is the only tradition in the world. And I work with Navayana Interfaith people. The only tradition who worship animals, not love animals. Everybody loves animals. America is a big animal lover, you know, dog and cat. But Hindu worship animals. Even we worship dogs. If you look at, there is one group, the dog is the temple sitting, and we worship bull, we worship trees, we worship rivers. Look at that, whatever nature is there, we worship. Because we see Atman in everything. Because the trees are created by Bhagwan, there is an Atman in tree. That's why we say that don't cut the tree unless. That's why we have what Vaksh Puja and all those things. That is the beauty of that Namaste. It is not just a greeting, it's more to it. And I am sure our rishis have thought a lot and came up with this word, the explanation. It's not just tossed somewhere that will say hi. It's like that. So that, and when you talk to someone like that, it gives pride in yourself and they feel good too. Oh, because tell me, when you say Namaste, you become a Hindu. No. Everybody says, I want to say Namaste. That's why a lot of my office colleagues, they like that. They say Namaste. Because they say, oh, what a wonderful way to greet. So that's the traditions we have brought from India. That's the next. Okay, then heroic people. These are the people, they, when you think of them, you feel good, right? The brave people. For example, Shivaji. Shivaji was the king who fought the invaders who came to India to establish Hindu Samaraja. So he was a brave king. There are a lot of some examples there. Meerabai. You know, he's such a popular character. Even, and you won't believe, in the same camp here. And I'm going to Gita now. So Gita touches Krishna and Krishna touches Gita. So same Meerabai has influenced, the character of Meerabai influenced many people outside of India, non-Hindus, because of the bhajan, her devotion, her pure devotion towards Bhagavan Krishna. And lot of non-Hindus have Meera name. It's a very popular. Non-Hindus, they keep Meera name because the character gives that attraction. Meera, I like that because of the devotion. So when you think of these characters, this is what we feel, oh, this itihas we belong to. That's the pride we need to have. That's what we need to continue with. So, then again, another thing is teachings, the books. This is a picture of Guru Granth Sahib, or Ramayana, or Mahabharata, or Ved. All our books, I mean, they were not just hymns of. That's why I used to say, I don't like the idea of app. App doesn't give you which Shastra gives. So we have to read in a book form. Keep it like that and read it. There's a lot of meaning behind reading the Shastra. And these books are not 200, 300 year old. There are thousands and thousands of years old. So last year we went to Caribbean. Caribbean country where Hindus came almost 160 years old. So I was visiting one of the museums in Caribbean and they had a Ramayana there. He took me to the museum and there was a Ramayana. And then he said this Ramayana was brought by, like, their sixth generation Hindus now, by his great-great-grandfather. And they still kept it, 150-year-old Ramayana in some museum. He won't believe. And he had tears in his eyes. The reason was that, because that was written in Audi, which is, they came from UP. And they cannot read that, Audi. So they kept the Ramayana in the museum just to see that our forefathers used to read that. What a valuable book. Yesterday they chanted Bhagavan Ram's characteristics from Valmiki Ramayana. Look at that, that's the character described. 16 shlok describes a wonderful character, a superlative human being like that. So with that, I'll tell you one thing. Why Ram is a superlative character? He had Ramayana, he right? Why? What is that you mean? You can say Ram is a superhero. It is not. Ram is a super. I believe. Why Ram is a superhero? What is that? There's Uma. She's outside. So why Ram is a superhero, a great character? Then he paid it. What is that? The Ram word is so popular, everybody loves that. Do you like something in Ram or not?
He's brave.
Yeah, what is that?
He's brave.
Brave, correct, right? Okay, so 3 years ago it happens, 4 years ago. Typically, US president go to schools. Obama went to one of the schools in Tampa and he was sitting with middle school kids. It was on national TV. It was because they broadcast on national TV. So he was sitting in Tampa with middle school kids and he was talking to those kids. I'm talking about Bhagwan Ram's characteristics. Okay? What do you like about Bhagwan Ram? Okay, think and then answer.
What are the qualities you think?
She knows it because she's chanting 16.
Yeah. So the, on chanting that reminds Uma, listen this. On chanting that reminds me. So typically we make our kids to chant, right? We have to be very careful here. Unless they understand, we should not keep doing that. Otherwise, one day everything will be dropped. It's very important. So there was a cultural program happening like we had yesterday, and one mother brought a kid that, oh, my kid can sing. The mothers are typically very enthusiastic, bringing kids on the stage and all those things. Oh, my kid can sing Bhagavad Gita. So okay, that's fine. So now kid came here and then chanted Bhagavad Gita, some shlok, right? Aham Vaishwanaro Bhutva Praninande Mahatata Prana Pan Samarita Pachamna. Wow, everybody clap. Then somebody asked, can you explain the meaning? Now kid has a problem, right? So he was only, the mother was standing back. Mother said, now she whispered the meaning in kid's ear that I pervading all every blue human being. That was the meaning of the shlok. Now look at the kid, what kid got. So kid said, my mother pervades in all the human beings. Because mother said, I pervade, right? So that happens when we just memorize things. So it's very important, Uma, when you think of this character. So going back to Obama. So Obama was working with kids, so he asked one of the kids, hey kid, beta bethya, sit down. All those kids there, sit quietly, right? Come here. Okay, so Obama asked one of the kids of middle schooler that he was chatting with kids. Okay, can we have a focus here? Because see, typically what happens when we have this kind of disturbance, so please settle down and I'll hold my talk for 30 seconds and then we'll continue. Because there's sometimes what happens, like some people are focusing, some are not. So it is waste of their time too. So let's sit down, settle down and I'll continue. Sit down. Okay, parents also, please focus, right? Volunteers will take care of kids. Parents, don't worry about your kids. We are sometimes too worried about kids also. So let them, the volunteers take care of them. So one of the kids asked Obama, Mr. Obama, if given a chance for you to have a dinner, look at that, right? He is a very smart politician. So he asked Obama, right, that if you given a chance to have a dinner with someone, whom will you choose? And Obama said, this is on national TV, I'm not making this. Obama said, Gandhi. Because I would like to have a dinner with Gandhi. The kid asked why. Obama said, because Gandhi is my role model. The person who can lead 300 million people with a common message. That's what I want. So, and this was, I was talking in one of the camps. And then Ram Navami was that weekend. Then I asked kids, you know, who was, somebody asked the same question to Gandhi once. That who's your role model? Now, who is Gandhi's role model? You know, yeah. Because if you go to Gandhi's like Samadhi in New Delhi, he said, Hey Ram. Actually, he died, he said, Hey Ram. Because he used to say, always, my role model is Ram. So Gandhi's role model is?
Ram.
Ram, right? And most powerful person on this earth as of today is who? Obama. US president is the most powerful person on this earth as of today. So look at that. Our most powerful person's hero is Gandhi. Gandhi's hero is Ram. So who is the most powerful person?
Ram.
So we belong to that race. So that is the glory. We should think of that, right? Then you feel good about it. Oh, we belong to that. But we have to connect those dots. And all these programs, teachings, books, and our, as a parent, it's our responsibility to connect those dots. If you don't connect those dots, again, the same thing, the heaviest load to carry is, there's nothing to carry. Next. So, yeah. Yeah, so again, going back to that, this is what the pillars of our history, this is what we owe, Hindus, right? Architecture, custom tradition, Hindu people, teachings, right? And this reveals our identity. So at home, whatever program you do in temples, just keep this mind. This is all our activities around this. If you are not doing around this, then we are wasting our time. But doesn't matter what lengthy puja we are doing in temple, if it is not along these lines, it's not a good use of all our resources and time. So we should take pride in our glorious dhyana. Next. Okay, so again going back to the first slide, I said Einstein said that. So who we are? Ravi. What is our identity? Can you read that?
Indian, American,
and
one
balance. Yes, so we have to have a balance between these three, right? And that is our identity. Not just Indian, not just American, not just Hindu. So Dayanand Saraswati ji, he is one of my mentors, he is a mentor of many people sitting here. So he used to say that, and I told you the story in the beginning, that we have a diamond to offer to the world. But unfortunately, sometimes we don't know that we have a diamond. It's like a beggar who died and the treasure was right below him. And he didn't know that I was sitting on the treasure. So we have a treasure in our heritage, our ancestor. But if we don't know how, we cannot offer to the world. So we have to practice ourselves first. Next slide. So going back to the quote Albert Einstein said, we owe not to Indians. When he is saying owe, he is not saying in terms of science or money. He is saying in terms of values. You know, parents may not give you, not. There is a very famous person in America, he died few years ago, Stephen Covey, right? A famous book he has written. What is the famous book?
Seven Habits of Successful People,
right? Stephen Covey, very famous speaker. Even every year, he died few years ago. Every time new US president is elected, Stephen Covey goes and stays in White House for 5 days to train them, the new staff. And all, they are all like very highly educated staff. Stephen Covey is a motivational speaker. Just to motivate them to work on values. So if you listen to Stephen Covey, his focus is values, values and values. He says methods can change, values won't change. Mother's relationship with son will remain or daughter will remain forever. It is 10,000 years ago or 10,000 years down the line. Same relationship, but the ways may change. Now my mother used to have all the time sari, but my son's mother doesn't have sari all the time, she has skirt also some of the time, and that's a change of time. But the relationship remains the same. The adoration for mother remains the same. The love for son or daughter remains the same. Doesn't matter mother is modern or old. So he talks, so look at that now. The point to remember is that Stephen Covey has recommended, he recommends books, he's a motivational speaker. So he recommends 23 books to read. Out of 23, six of them are Hindu books. Six of them, almost 30% Hindu books. Stephen Covey, he says, read Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, Life of Gandhi, Dhampada, the Buddha's life, and one more book, six books. So it's all six Hindu books. Look at that. The guy who is a motivational speaker of America and the best, he says six of them, you must read. And we, if we are ashamed, if we don't read, right? Outside people are saying, read these books. And if we don't read Bhagavad Gita at home, we don't read Upanishad messages, then we are doing something wrong. Right? So much of time we have, so much energy, so much brain Bhagavan has given by God gifted, we have rishis, DNA is running in us and we are intelligent, not because we do something good. If we are not using them, then there is something wrong with us, our program. So it's very important. So I again say that was Einstein mean. Einstein didn't mean the money or science. Even the value Hindus can, Indians can give, provide to the world. And that's what Dhyanand is saying. Same thing. We have a diamond to offer. Let's practice ourselves, right? If you have a diamond ring, you say, oh, it's a nice diamond ring, but I should know this is a diamond ring. So it's very important. Yeah, next slide, please. Okay, so this is about BHP. One more time. This is about BHP America, which done a lot of camps. The purpose of BHP America is to create a dynamic, vibrant society. Same, based on those values. And these camps and all, we have many are running, many organizations, but PHP America has supported many of them in the past 46 years. Okay, this is the mission of all our Hindu organization, not only BHP America. Sanskar, it's very important to have Sanskar. First thing, Sanskar, values. Second is awareness. We need to work with outside people, bring awareness in people we work, our society, our family, what are our values, then service, social service. Now, see, that's one thing we are missing in America. We Hindus have a lot of wealth, everybody knows we are the second richest community in this country, immigrant. Sometimes we are first actually. But look at the contribution we give into mainstream America is very minimal. And I work with government agencies, and there is a data that our contribution is very minimal because most of our time and resources are gone into maintaining our own things, our own programs, our own temples. That is fine too. Nobody stops that. But is it not our duty to contribute to mainstream America? There are needs here too. It's not. India is only poor country. In America, there are 70% people. If you look at the salary range, it's $28,000 per capita income. 70% people have $30,000 per capita income, which is actually, we cannot even survive. Indians cannot even think of that money we can survive. 70% population in this country are like that. So it's not, we can do here also, service, that is social service. So there are projects, I mean, we have, I can share with Sanjay ji and Kumar ji, when you sit in the Indianapolis Forum, please discuss. Don't just come here for fun and just be part of it. We construct this, do tangible things, that's important. So I'm going to give to Sanjay ji and Kumar ji, the Seva in America, there is a project, take part, campus can take part, it's wonderful. Temples are busy in some other things. As a group, we can do that, as a Hindu group, but collectively, we should do that, report to one place that this is the service we are doing. And we should do that. Like supporting, we in Pittsburgh, for the last 3 years, we are doing a program called Support Family of Our Troops. We do a small Antakshari program, very local program. Local artists, they come, perform Antakshari, we raise some funds, and give to the family of troops. There are agencies in America, there are orphan kids, family troops, I mean, they are like disabled soldiers. They are not like charities. Why not become part of that charity? So we raise funds, we get them, we get letters from them. So thank you very much. My kid got this because of your donations. And we work with orphan kids here in Pittsburgh, I do, and some other cities also. And they feel good. And it is our duty also. It's not just we are doing something in favor to someone. So that is Seva in America. So please talk to Kumar ji or Sanjay ji, and I'll provide some more detail and be active in that. Tangible. I'm telling you, that's what our kids are going to 200 years down the line. Our parents were smart to contribute to taught us something which is just beyond our mind. The Swami used to say, the whole purpose is like me. That rag is going on in our mind. Myself. That's it. Come out of that. Become part of the society. So and then network also. We have to work together. That is very important. Because if we want to work together, again it's like a fringe thing, so it's very important that we work together. And that's why this collective program, take part in networking program. We have a broader networking program, Kumar ji knows, Sanjay ji knows, so take part in this program and be active. I'm telling you, if we are not active, there will be 100 Donald Trump standing on this dais and say that immigrants are not doing anything, and they are not wrong if they say that. So please, I mean, I'm very activist in that sense. Please be active. And I, as a Hindu, I'm active. And I don't go out and go, and you won't believe I go like this in many programs. Like this, Boy Scouts and everything. And they love it. They say, oh, as long as you come and contribute and talking values, we are fine. So please, right? So we have to change the presentation, then we take another 10 minutes and I'm done it. Then another presentation, challenges. This is a whole long break. I give this presentation in sometime 1 and 1.5 hours. So I'm going to wrap up in 10 minutes. Look at that. That's a challenge. So this is a mission we should all understand. This is a common mission for the Hindu community. Tonight is an annuity of Hindu Dharma, and I will talk about the values, right? Strongly focus on these, the future generation of Hindus. Forget about now, I should not, we should not forget too much about our Vrat and Upvas and all those things. And the larger US society, because we are part of it. Hindu community, parents and mentors can address these very important needs in a very tangible way. And the key word is the parents and mentors. We have a responsibility towards our children. And very tangible way we can do this. So it's otherwise like the same thing. We can ask them to say Gita Shlok, but if they don't memorize, they don't understand the character of Krishna, we are not doing the right thing. So next slide. This is what I was talking about. Look at this. This is a income. Asian is 80% Indian, right? $74,000 for income. And the African American people is $35,000. We are more than double of the income. That is what we have. And look at this. People know this. These are the facts. I have not made these numbers. These numbers are available on Department of Labor website and all those things. And people know that. So if we have that, why don't we contribute? That is very important. Otherwise, people will question. So yeah, next slide. I mean, I have to rest a little bit. Okay. Next, look at this. This is a picture. Okay, kids. What is in this picture? You see these three things. What are these three things? What are these three things? What are these things? What they do? What they do? There are three different models. They play music. That's correct. So now I can think one more time. Nina.
Yeah.
Okay. So look at that. Three generations in America. One thing is common in these instruments is music. Similarly, one thing in common in three generations is the Hindu identity. Dharma is common. Whether grandfather, whether Dr. Ahuja, or Purnimaji, or Purnimaji's grandkid, or for example, or me, Hansa's grandkid. One thing is common. All three are here in this camp for one reason. Because all three love. Look at Veer. He has been enjoying camp for the last 2 days, right? Chaos in this camp when she was kind of 6-7 years old, Veer's mother. Why Veer is here? Because there is something inside Veer saying, oh, my identity, my Hindu Dharma. Why Dr. Ahuja is here for 2 days? In spite of Veer's 80 years old. Because he loves that identity. He loves that dharma. Which is common between, now 2 days I haven't seen bonding between Dr. Ahuja and Veer. They have become very good friends. Like Dr. Ahuja holding Veer. What is that common? Both love that identity. That is called very important. Why Purnima? I mean, I have seen her for the last 15 years, every Balgopala, every camp she is there. And most of the time she misses those lectures because she is in the kitchen. And I tell her all the time, when you go to the kitchen, you miss, but you don't miss. You win, you don't lose because you are doing something more important than that. So that, but the common is this. So that is very important. Okay, that's the mistake we make. I say that. This is a typically program Vishnu Gujarati Samaj, right? Festival done in New Jersey, this was that. It's a comic on that. And then the guy is saying on the dais, if we don't speak, read, write Gujarati, how are we going to expect our children to? Well, the guy is speaking in English. So now you are speaking in English and telling that if you don't speak, write English, how are we? That's the mistake we make. You have to put in extra effort. You won't believe I have some Muslim friends. They make sure their kids learn Quran in Arabic and understand how you don't believe. And I talk to them. And that's why Dhyananji used to say, don't worry about too much Sanskrit. Take one shlok, understand it, imbibe it. And when you talk to Bhagwan, Bhavarya, one of Swamiji makes the joke that when you go to Bhagwan, that's why your prayer is not answered. Because when you say prayer in Sanskrit, Bhagwan anyway knows, but you don't know what you're saying. So Bhagwan says, I don't know what you're saying. But you don't know what you're saying. So say in the language you know. So you can say in Malayalam or Hindi or whatever, or Sanskrit, but understand. Then Bhagwan will listen. Otherwise, it's a one-way communication. You're just chanting, and Bhagwan says, oh, this guy is saying, I don't know what he's saying. He or she doesn't know himself. So it's very important that we do something which is meaningful for kids also. You can skip that. Yeah. Okay, so this, you can skip this also. Okay, so these are some of the challenges we face. One more slide. Okay, this is the challenges we face. And I said this is a 1 hour presentation. So maintaining identity is a challenge for all, parents and kids together. These are together challenges. Is our belief system upgraded with time? It is very important. Our practices should be upgraded with time. And I said, I am against app for Gita. But yeah, we have to change the way. For example, prayer. I mean, typically our Shastra says that Sandhya Vandana, if you do, you get up 4 o'clock in the morning, take bath and do Sandhya Vandana, which is not possible, right? But our new guru says that no, you can do without even just brush, keep yourself clean, sit in a nice place, do meditation. You don't have to take bath. You can take this one, but no, you can still do that. You can still talk to Bhagwan without taking bath. So those we have to upgrade our. Of course, engaging Hindu groups in Seva service, I already talked about. We have to collectively work in Seva. That's a very important challenge we face, our kids face. And I see that our kids do like some programs, Boy Scouts and all that, but very low level. Leadership, we face leadership, like who can lead the program. There are always we need, like, look at the Nikhil and Nina and all, Arna, what is the name? Arna?
Arna,
yeah. I mean, that's what we need to teach them, lead these things. And so we said it take over, because that is missing. So it is very good actually that you should. Yeah, next one. Okay, the, you can skip that. I mean, I have already covered in some of the ways. Yeah, please go ahead. Okay, this is again the walk talk. A lot of time parents may say, oh, do yoga, do this thing. Look at that. If you say, do yoga, it will help you. Oh, your belly has to be good, straight and tall, right? It's not, you can say people that do yoga. Do yoga, first you do that. So there is one of my Guruji says that yoga for Hindus, this is a very careful, very powerful, profound statement. Yoga for Hindus is not twisting the body. Yoga for Hindu is not twisting the body, it is straightening the mind. Okay? So that is where, so mind, for us it is buddhi. Buddhi which is leading towards Bhagwan. Now the next step, that is yoga for us. Whole Gayatri Mantra we say, at the end we say, Dhiyo Yona Prachodaya. So one, take my buddhi towards you. That is the yoga for Hindus. All these physical things are very little lower. So we have to do that next year. And next one. keep going. Okay, hold on. I'm almost done. So this is, go back. This is a picture, very recent picture. This is my son Gyan. He came to Indianapolis to see Hansa Dua. And Veer and Raj, Veer is 2 years old, Raj is Veer's brother, right, 1 year old. And then he started touching Gyan Bhaiya's Charan, Charan Sparsh, he's in Gujarat. So they are doing Charan Sparsh. So I called when Gyan, they sent on WhatsApp this picture, and I called Gyan, my son. Gyan, make sure it is not Charan Sparsh, it is Acharan Sparsh. When somebody touches your feet, they don't touch your Charan, they touch your Acharan, the character in you. So it's very important if you make some younger world to touch your feet, it's a character you have to have inside. It's not Charan, it is the Acharan. It is the character which they adore, not the body they adore. So I told Gyan, Gyan is a challenge here, but bigger challenge for me, when Gyan touches my feet, now Gyan's next generation today is a challenge for me. Gyan touches my feet, I cannot say Gyan, be happy. I have to be happy first. I cannot say Gyan, be disciplined. I have to be disciplined myself first. So it's the character. So that is very important when somebody has to lead by example. Right? So next slide. Again, going back to the, this is the last slide and we'll do a small video and get back. Yeah. So this is a slide which John Kennedy said when the man landed on moon, that it's very important when you land on moon, but the important thing is returning safely to Earth. So doing program is not important, but making the completion of the program, the goal is achieved, that is important. Good program is fine. So this is the last slide, now there is a video that you play. Is there sound I think we can connect up on? There is a Ramayan video. Yes. Yeah. Ramayan. Look at that now. See what you said is here. Good.
Time of gate. So how is it up? भारत का राज्य दूसरा ये तो भारत
करके 14 वर्ष तक बंद मिला बस इतनी सी बात है इतना विवाद था ये तो बड़ी प्रसन्नता की बात है मुझे माता पिता
दोनों के बच्चों को पालन करने का एहसास मिला जब उन्हें मंदिर का बड़े भाग्य मिलता है.
Look at that. That's why we're closing our camp. Look at the message. Look at this face smiling. That's it. That's all. That is dhati. When the shlok you said, there is a characteristic in a dhati. The patience, the perseverance, the depth of character. That's it. That is the character of God. So I think we should take home this message. That when we go home, take this character and invite them. Invite them. And work together, do seva. And that's it. So hopefully we'll see you next year. Continue doing the right thing.